Does anybody not know who this is? I didn't think so. So the man who needs no introduction, Ken Wood.
Well, thank you. Like I said, I was expecting to. Last night I had my bee inspection outfit out over here, and I had this outfit out over here. I said, which way are we going to go? Until Ed calls and says, Ken, what do you think we should do? I said, well, it doesn't look good. I says, you probably should make alternate plans. And that was a wise choice, because even though we got some sun there earlier, I was coming in and the sun hits the windshield and gets warm in the car. I said, wow, we're probably going to be okay here. And then all of a sudden the dark clouds come over and it looks threatening. So he made a wise choice bringing this inside. And again, I've done this talk three of the clubs outdoors at opening the hives and actually doing what I'm going to talk about. And then three of the ones have been indoors. You know, I did Bristol just Tuesday night indoors. Southern Berkshire kind of did indoors. And then I did State Beekeepers in Maine. And then I did Worcester Beekeepers Outdoors. And I did the Northern Berkshire Beekeepers Outdoors, the same talk. So I've gone across the state with this, and some outside, some indoor. And I think it's just as good either way. And this has taken years for me over the years to kind of look at this and what's important and figure out what gets me through the winter the best, and what beekeepers do that gets them through the winter. And I've looked at that, and I see the big span, seeing beekeepers across the state. I can see what's working, what's not working, management-wise. And management is a difference. There's no question in my mind. Management plays a big part in overwintering. There are other factors too, but if your management is correct, your odds are much, much better. So, like I say, this talk I've been giving most of them earlier, because I based this on August 31st. So we're here about a month behind, but a lot of this you can catch up on. If you missed that you should have done earlier, you can still catch up with some of it. But anyway, let me share a story quickly here, like I like to all times. In Somerville, I was out in Somerville a while back, and a friend that I started beekeeping, a friend of mine, and all of a sudden I get a call from him. This was on a Friday, and he said, Ken, Charlie, right here. I says, Charlie, how are you doing? He says, horrible. He says, can you get out here, please? You know, as a friend, I'm asking, can you come out here? And I says, Charlie, what's wrong? He says, just can you come out here? He says, so he didn't put down the phone. So I thought the guy was dying or something, you know? So I quickly shot down a mass spike to Somerville. Most of you probably know Somerville, very congested area, tight. A downtown Charlie keeps him not far, right near the downtown area in Somerville. And all of a sudden I get there. Charlie's there waiting at the door. He comes running out. I says, what's wrong, Charlie? He says, Ken, come over here. We went two houses over to this house. And as we're walking over, a crowd of people, about 15 or 20 people, they're looking at the front door of this house. They're out in the street on the sidewalk. And they're looking at this. We get closer, and I can see there's like a cloud of bees flying around the screen door of this house. Right there off of the main drag there in Somerville. And all of a sudden I go in there, and the mother comes. They were in the family, two children, the mother and father. They were in a swimming pool in the backyard. Big round, these round swimming pools. Well, a mother and a younger child come into the kitchen after in the swimming pool, and all of a sudden they walk into the house, and there on the globe light fixture in the kitchen is a swarm of bees. You can imagine that somebody that hasn't seen honeybees or don't know honeybees sees that, freaks out, she screams. And the neighbors come out, and a couple people on the street, and she runs out, slams, closes the screen door. Well, I get there, this crowd of people, and these bees, all trying to get to their queen. So I get there, first thing I do, I says, I open the screen door, and they just flock. You're letting them all in. I says, I know I am. They have to get to their queen. That's why, because they thought this was the attack of the bees, a swarm of bees attacking the people in the house. So anyway, make a long story short, She says, you're going to get them out of here? I said, yes. She says, how long is it going to take you? I said, I'll be back tonight at 8:30. And I, you know, in my mind, I'm thinking, I said, just leave the screen door open. I says, she said, we can't use our house till 8:30 tonight. I said, you can use the living room, the bedrooms. They won't bother you. Just don't go into the kitchen. And she says, well, how are we going to eat? I said, do yourself a favor. Take yourself off to eat. Which, you know, how difficult is that? She said, I guess we can do that. So anyway, she says, all right, you promise you're going to be back. I could see this fear of her. You're going to be back. I said, I promise. I'll be back here by 8:30. Just leave that, because in my mind, that swarm might pick up and leave in the meantime. And I won't even have to do anything. But not the case. I came back at 8:30. I had my ladder, had a white bucket, and I had some sugar syrup and a spray bottle like I go everywhere for swarms. And so all of a sudden, I get there, oh, thank God you're here. She says, we're afraid to use the living room in the house. We were upstairs all day. I was at my friend's in Quincy, good friend. And so I get there, and I could see. I put the ladder up. I put the white bucket, so the swarm, it was a globe white. So the swarm was almost right into the bucket. And there, well, I get up, I spray them with sugar syrup, spray them down fairly well with sugar syrup. And then I got up on the ladder, I could see the four of them from just like that. And all of a sudden, with my bare hands, boom, right in the plop, put the cover on, thank you. That's all there is to it. I said, that's it. I says, what you see being done here, do not try at home. This is being done by a trained professional. And I went away, but she says, I talked with Matt, I get the swarm. Like Charlie took the swarm. He's got a nice hive that's now progressing very well, very nice. I'll take a swarm any day. And so anyway, they'll make a long story short. Oh, Candy said, thank you, thank you. So I was so worried that they'd get stung up in the house and everything. She said, that's why I called you. And so I said to him, I said, take the kids out and Dad and Mom, bring them over to the hive. Let them see the hives in the yard. And so guess what? After that, the kids go over there every couple of days to look at the bees and see the bees. He gave them some honey. Dad's been going over. The family's starting beekeeping next year. So what could have been an awful situation turned out to, it was kind of nice, you know. I mean, I've been meaning to write an article for a newsletter about this because it was kind of nice. What turned could have been a tragedy type of thing turned into a real good situation. But again, the urban beekeeping, I told Charlie, you've got to keep the swarms from swarming because in a tight neighborhood, you see what happens. There's not many trees in all those houses. They went right into the kitchen, right into the kitchen. Which is, you know, I don't see that too often. I have seen swarms inside a house that have swarmed with doors open, but usually it's a porch on the front, but this was a unique situation. But you sure, when I opened the door and there was, you know, droves just going in, trying to get in, they weren't foraging. When she closed the door, they couldn't get to the queen, they couldn't get to the cluster. And so anyway, it was kind of a neat situation. So anyway, here I am. By the way, how many here are first or second year beekeepers? Oh, good, good. Okay, third and fourth year beekeepers. And more than 5 years? All right, so the large portion are in the first 4 years of beekeeping. So I'm going to kind of gear this to that level of beekeeper so that you understand, because I just did Bristol, and now I'm talking about combining through newspaper. The new people there, what was he talking about? Couldn't understand what combining through newspaper was, so I'm going to keep it so everybody understands this. Anyway, I'm the state apiary for the last 41 years, been inspecting bees, keeping bees a lifetime, and I've seen it all. And in that many years, I've seen every situation. Every year, I see the problems going in beekeeping. You know, and they change from season to season. Early in the season, there's certain problems, and mid-season, there's other problems that I see. End of the season, other problems. And we're dealing kind of with the end of the season here now and what problems you're going to be dealing with and how to deal with them. In my mind, that's the best way to deal with them. But anyway, what I like to do, one of the things we'll just look at, I'll go through, is this. You want to, first of all, before that, I didn't put that on here, do an inventory of your hives. An inventory, go through frame by frame, your top brood chamber, your bottom brood chamber. what do I have in here? So you know, for management purposes, what you need to do. In other words, you go through your top root chamber, this outside frame, honey, all honey. Next frame, all honey. Third frame over, half a frame of brood, and half a frame of honey. Third, fourth frame, and inventory, what's in each frame? So you've got an idea, bottom brood chamber. Five, frame one, pollen. Frame two, pollen. Frame three, pollen. Why I say that, there's loads of pollen this year down there. Then go right through that bottom brood chamber, two frames of brood. And you inventory that way, you got know in your mind what you've got and what you need to do to manage that hive. Okay, so that's one thing, go through. Then, as I go through these here, that's what I'm gonna be talking about. Monitoring varroa mite levels, checking the brood setup, making sure you don't, not honey bound, pollen bound, checking for diseases, monitor for swarming and supersedure, monitor stores for the winter, and consider winter preparation, ventilation, insulation, brood, quantity, hive setup. That's kind of what we're going to talk about here and somewhat in detail. But the first one, like I say, is, and may not be particularly this order, but when you do that inventory, one of the things I'm going to make is an important point. Most people don't realize you need right now, September and October, you have to understand your bees are going to start brood rearing toward the end of January, early February. You right now, you've got a lot of old bees. It looks, those hives look strong as long as nothing's going on. And they look good. Wow, you feel comfortable. But guess what? Those bees, a lot of those bees are going to be dead by the time January rolls around. And I see this with people, they call me, Ken, they were strong all of a sudden. In January, there's only a little cluster left. Well, what was the problem? Well, the problem was they were honey-bound and pollen-bound in the brood chamber, and the queen had no room to lay. And I'm seeing that as I've been around the last 2 weeks. We've had a kind of a good flow. We hadn't had honey all year. And then now toward the end, we got a burst of the fall honey, the last 3 weeks, three and a half weeks is when it all came in. Before that, nothing. I had my supers dry, honey supers dry, and now all of a sudden, I had all, got this honey. My scale hives, I got two scale hives. You could see the weight being put on. I got a computerized one. I got these two scales, $3,000 scales, and they monitor everything, temperatures in there. Every 15 seconds, how much weight comes in or is lost. The swarm goes out, how many pounds was that swarm? The computers do everything. They were USDA scales. So I monitor, and I saw, wow, 26 pounds of nectar in one day back there toward the end of August. 26 pounds of nectar. Now that's not honey, that because they evaporate the water, but 26, that's tremendous flow in one day. And so what was happening, the goldenrod, the Joe Piwi, the Chinese bamboo, and the fall asters, which came early, all came together, and there was this intense flow. So what happens is they bring it all in, and you didn't have your honey supers on, or didn't have enough honey supers on, guess what? They're going to put it down below. So what you're looking for, and crucial, there's a correlation here. September, October, to get enough young bees in your winter cluster, you need to keep 7 to 8 frames of brood. That's what you're looking for right now for October. If you miss September and you're honey bound and you don't have 8 frames of brood, like the lady who just called me here a little while ago when I came in, she had the whole top, 10 frames of honey, 6 frames of pollen down below, and then honey and pollen frames. There were only 2 patches of brood this big. So that was yesterday. That's she'd call me because I left the note. I said, you got a problem as far as brood space. I said, you're not going to get any September, October. September's too late. I said, at least you can get October bees. So the point I'm making here, you need, the correlation is, you need 7 to 8 frames of brood. Don't have to be 100% brood, but they have to be 2/3 to 3/4 of brood. The honey crowns, okay, that's perfect right now. But September and October, that would be the perfect. A crown of honey with 2/3 brood, you need 8 of those type of frames. Now, what you can do is, you know, in the USDA, we used to do, I can't tell you how many times I've done this frames. You can take a frame and on a frame, there are 32 squares, they call it, or blue. And, you know, when I first started with Jeff Pettis there in that study, we take a frame, they showed us how to put this right on, and you can count how much brood there is in the frame, how many squares. And these squares will relate to how many bees are going to be hatching. And we could then calculate. And there's a strong correlation. What will happen is 7 to 8 frames will correlate, and I think Ed's shaking beeswax and weight them at the end of the season. 7 to 8 frames of brood correlates to a cluster of about 8 to 9 pounds of bees, which is the ideal size of a cluster for the wintering in the winter months. Now, we did it on December 5th that we waited. The brood was all done, so there's no more brood, and that correlated to an 8-pound cluster. And that's what we're finding. The clusters, a good cluster in the fall is 8 pounds of bees. People think 80,000 bees. Maybe it's still in October, but come December, you're down to, you know, 3,500 times 8 is how many bees go into a winter cluster. And that's a good cluster. And that's what you want, because what's happened, if you don't have September, October bees, here's what happens. You look good till the beginning of December, but then all those old bees are dying. If you had no bees, not enough brood, you're going to end up with a small cluster. And that's what people are seeing, that small cluster. And you get a cold spell, you find the little cluster dead because they can't generate the heat. They can't stop brood rearing until later. A little cluster during those cold spells, they can't generate enough heat to stop brood rearing. And guess what? Those bees are now getting older. And if you, September bees will live for 4 months. We tag them, we mark them, and our September bees, October bees live for 4 to 4.5 months. So you figure September bees will go October, November, December, January. They're done. October bees go November, December, January, February, maybe a little into March. Those are the bees that carry your cluster so they can stop brood rearing and you can get a regeneration of your hive numbers. So this is important. This is probably one of the most important things that I see as mistakes. I've been the last 2 weeks out there. Guess what I'm seeing? Honeybound, pollenbound, because of that late honeyfall. That's a mistake. People, you know, everybody comes August, everybody gets nervous. I better stop feeding my bees. They don't know how many honeybound, and yet they're feeding their bees. They give them more. That's a mistake. You really, as long as they get crowns of honey, you should wait till the end of October. You want that to be brood space, 7 to 8 frames. Okay, so inventory, that's why that inventory is important. It tells you where you are for numbers and how many bees you're going to end up with in a cluster.
So say you're in that situation, how do you remedy it?
How do you handle it? That's what we're going to get to here in a minute. The way you handle that is two ways. This young lady just called me, I was telling you about. I was talking here, and you take one or two choices. You've got to either, if you have drawn out comb, deep frames of drawn out comb, and you can take those honeybound frames out, put them into the freezer until the beginning of November sometime, and put in those empty frames. Now, loads of people there in Worcester County, for respect, have done that. Or if you don't have deep frames, they're worth their weight in gold right now. Because what happens is that's much easier. Then come the end of October, early November, guess what you can do? Take out the frames that you put in there for brood and put in, you've got instant food. You don't have to bother trying to stuff sugar syrup in. Now you've got honey frames you just put back there. It's much better, in my mind, than sugar syrup. No question about it. I see less saccharide, less chocolate, a lot of things in a spring with bees that have sugar syrup versus honey. Honey's got, you know, as you people know, but bees produce honey and there's certain qualities that honey the bees need. And so as a result, what I'm saying here is that inventory is going to, and if you don't, now you got to rectify like Ed and I were talking earlier. You know what's wrong, now you got to act on it. What good is it? Well, I've got 10 frames of brood honey in the top chamber. If you don't act on it and do something, you're in trouble come the end. It looks good until, I'm telling you, until the beginning of December. And then what? Those old bees are dying. You come to Christmas time, you have a little cluster. I get calls all the time. Ken, I don't know. There were loads of bees, and now there's just this little cluster. Well, guess what? You had all the old bees. You didn't have any new bees hatching. That's what happens. That's a major error. That's, I address this. If I can't emphasize anything here, that's the thing that most people don't realize. They're too, they want to get packed out for the winter. Think, I got to get plenty of food. I see people sugar syrup on August 30th. Sugar syrup on, they got loads of honey because we got that flow starting just about the third and last week of August. Because nectar was just coming in. And so, anyway, that is the way you would handle it. Much easier to take the frames out. The other way is you have to take them out, spin them out, spin the honey out, and then put them back right away. Can't leave them without frames. Or if you can get from somebody, an older beekeeper, but again, most beekeepers don't want to part with their drawn out combs. You try, all the new beekeepers try calling. I've got, because so many problems. So they end up having to spin out. Our extractors in Worcester have been going just steady, renting, borrowing, because the problem is big. It's widespread. So go through if you haven't and take a look at that situation. You still got October to hopefully rectify that and part of November to get some brood if you haven't. Because I'm telling you, that's the major error why people lose bees and why come January, February, you got this little cluster, it's not starting brood bearing. And as a result, now that's what you want to see. Not, you're going to see that now, but guess what? You want to see that coming into December, the end of December. You want to, of course, they'll be much tighter with the cold weather. They constrict to keep the heat. Right now, you see them there through spread throughout because it's been warmer. But with that cold day we had yesterday, I'll tell you, I was in some hives. They're tight. They weren't moving. The brood was covered this thick with bees, keeping that brood warm because it was hot. All of a sudden, now cold. Yesterday, I had to work very carefully so that bees would fall off in that cold, have a hard time regenerating and being able to come into the hive. So be careful when you go. Cold days, they drop. They can't get back into the hive. Often that's because cold, they can't fly. Those wing muscles can't generate the heat to fly. So be careful when you do on a cold day, take out and do it, and best to wait till a day like 65 and up. That way, those bees all clump tight, and you take a frame out, and all of a sudden a clump of bees all falls. So be careful when you do your management. Now, what I'm going to talk about here is evaluating your queen. So that's what you want to see. You love to see A-frames like that. That's what you like to see. They're perfect. But that's really not perfect. You want to see some crowns of honey because you want to make sure you got food. You just want to see full frames of honey. So that now takes us to our second topic, evaluating the queens. It's a little late now, but if you got a poor queen, I told people, and we've shown them what good pattern is, what a poor pattern is, and you can still requeen if you can get queens. It's getting much more tough to get queens. But if she's poor now, you say, well, maybe she'll improve. She's not good now. By January, when she starts rearing forward, guess what? She's going to be worse. So I recommend looking at your queens. Is she laying a nice brood pattern? Or is it really, piecemeal? Some here, some there a little bit. It's a lot of empty cells. So, but don't blame her if she don't have any space. Like I had one young lady said, well, my queen's not doing a good job. I only got 2 frames of brood. Well, we went through with her. I showed her why. I said, this isn't that it's a bad queen. She had 2 patterns. They were all full, nice pattern. But guess what? Everything else was full of pollen. I said, look at all the pollen. Oh, she says, they don't clean it out. I said, no, they're stockpiling that for winter. I says, it's up to you now to move it and improve it, but it's not your queen. She thought it was a queen and only found two patches, and that's why I went out. That's why she had requested an inspection. And I straightened her out, and so she, that's, you know, the one particular one. And she is very dedicated. She wants her bees to make it, but she, you know, first year beekeepers, it's tough. You folks, a steep learning curve, and I understand where you're at, and it's tough. Nice to have a mentor come out and evaluate with you. You people are first year, call Ed, maybe you can get a mentor to double check on you to see if you're not sure what you should have in there. And that's why mentors are great. You know, we started a mentor appreciation for people recommending mentors for an award, the Worcester County Star Mentor Award. We've had 8, 9 people. If they treated you extra well as a mentor, whatever, some beautiful recommendations have been read from the mentees to about the mentors. Tear-jerking type of recommendations. So that's what you'd like to see, that too. The speckle, you're always going to have that little bit of that speckle, empty cells there, cells that are warped, they're not perfect six-sided, they might be dirty inside, there might be wire exposed on the bottom. So you're always going to get a little, but that is a perfect root frame. That's what we call a 32 over 32 square frame. This is, if I put this over the frame, that would be almost, that's 32 squares. That's what we evaluate, that's what we like to see, especially in the spring when they're building, those are the kind of frames you love to see. They're going to give you the 80,000 bees that you need to get nectar come the middle of May. Now, that's what you don't want to see is a very speckled pattern like that. That's a poor queen. And so if there's space and you're seeing that kind of a pattern, that's a poor queen. You need to replace it, there's no question. So I'm not going to dwell on that. I think everybody can evaluate. Just be sure it's not that she don't have space. Or the second reason, if there's mites, heavy mites under the cappings, and they're pulling up the dead larva that never made it to adulthood because of mites, you're going to get a speckled pattern. People blame the queen. It's not the queen. It's the fact that mites are taking down the pupa. You see the uncapped pupa heads. They pull, they chew off the head, decapitate it, and then they pull out the mummy and drop it off. And you see a speckled pattern with high mite count. So be careful not to blame the queen for that. And that's what happened here. That's in this case.
There's a lot of color in that picture. Are they maybe pollen bound?
There's pollen, but that's not pollen bound. There's enough space in there that she should be laying a better pattern. So you can see here. Now this is a case with already some mite damage. Now the queen. Obviously, I know people hate to do this and reply, oh, maybe she'll get better. I understand. So, whole thing, I don't want to kill my queen. Down in Uxbridge, one young lady down there, we just went through, that was earlier in the year, I gave her the queen. She says, I can't do it, you kill her. I says, I'm not going to kill your queen. And I says, you've got to do it, because she had a new queen waiting there when I inspected the hives. She says, you do it. I says, I'm not going to do it. So, guess what? I gave her the queen. I said, just crush the head quick. You know, that's the way, the best way, painless. You don't want to, someone put them in a cage and just let them die. You know, whatever. It's more. I know, and either way, it's a tough way, but to crush. So she takes in the hand, instead of crushing, she goes to stop. Guess what? The queen flew up right into the hive, and I said to Alice, I says, you've got to go now tomorrow, find her and get her. She calls me next day, Ken, guess what? I found her and I got her. This time I killed her. I'm kind of proud of it, but that's queen. Now, the other issue that we're dealing with here is mites. There's no question in my mind that is probably the overriding reason people losing their hives starting in October, November. I'm already seeing it. Grow my collapsed hives, I'm seeing it. In some cases, I catch it just at the right time, they're able to save it. In some cases, I've already told the beekeepers, there's no saving, our past honey queen. She's just at her house, and she called me here too on my way in. She says, well, what should I do? I said, there's no way to sing that high. It was just the mom devastated. You know, the had deformed wing, it had so speckled. It was already on its way down. I couldn't save it. So that's was mice. And so what? How do we deal with this? Obviously, it's important, I think, to evaluate throughout the season. And generally, mites reach a peak, particularly when you know people that have package hives. If you have package hives, what's going to happen is about August, the mites are reaching kind of a peak. And if you don't do something, your hive is going to collapse. So your ideal situation, you monitor. Now, obviously, there's a number of ways of monitoring. I'm not going to tell you how to do it. I'll just share with you the fact that alcohol wash is probably the most effective way to find your mite levels. Now, you're going to see them. You're going to be able to tell, because you're going to start to see, and you'll see a slide here in a minute, certain signs are going to, when it's real heavy, certain signs are going to start to appear. But that's when it's almost too late. You've got to monitor throughout the season. I'd say a good time to monitor about June, because this past year I had someone went at highs I had to deal with in June because the mites were high. For the majority, I didn't deal to it till the end of July, early August. And that seems to be kind of where, but don't go by that, because like I said, I had 17 hives early June. The mite levels and why are quite better. Grooming cause, I don't know what it is. But I know 17 were already heavy. Alcohol, isopropyl, you put it, and these are free. And you get these from Kim, the chief apiary inspector, for you to use the jar with a screen. And what you do is put alcohol 3/4 of the way, and then you take your frame, again, of bees, take out a brood frame. You want a brood frame, because this is near where most of your mites are going to be found. And you take the frame, you can do it one of two ways. You can get yourself a pan, a metal pan or a plastic pan, and just make sure the queens are not on there. It's just a little secret, so. Give it a bang, and then scoop up where the half cup mark is of bees. Okay, so, or come right up the frame. The other way to do it is, you ensure there's no queen, you've asked somebody else to double check that frame, you come right up and just with your hand, brush right in until you get to the half cup mark with bees. Okay, and then you put this on, shake them up, just like this, 10-15 minutes. And then take a nice white bowl, and what you can do, alcohol and the mites will come out, and your bees stay right behind in here. The only thing is, I found with these smaller jars, the bees are so tight that the mites get clogged in, so I do a second wash, and every time I found more mites. I'm now using a bigger jar I should have brought with me, the double size of this one. This is all right if you do a double wash. So I do it again, pour them in, and then you can count how many mites you've got. If you've got five or more mites on a half a cup of bees, 300 bees, you should be treating, doing something to take care of your mites. Now, this is the best method, most effective, because those mites that are under those abdominal sections, and there's questions, are they sucking the fat or the blood of the bee? There's right now some controversy, but one of the young researchers in Maryland has found that it's after the fat that they're after, as opposed to the hemoglobin, the blood. And so, whichever, it doesn't matter. The mites are going to take that bee down. They're under those abdominal sections, right close to where they can suck out. And you don't see them. People think you have to open up. I don't see any mites on my bees. You are not going to see them. The majority are there, or they're under the brood cappings, sucking blood off of the larva. And so what you've got to do then is if you got five or more in alcohol wash, you got to treat. And I can give you, I'm not going to recommend anything about that, but we have these brochures with every possible treatment. Now, what you're going to be careful about is temperature-dependent versus non-temperature-dependent treatments. If you're treating in August, you can use temperature-dependent, you know, treatments. If you're treating in the middle of September on, temperature-dependent, unless you got that week we had this last week with 90 degree temperatures. But other than that, with the cold mornings, cold nights, temperature-dependent stuff is not going to work. It's great, a couple of them, because they get under the cappings. But people think you put mitre or any of the heat-dependent, and they're going to do the job. It's too cold. It's not going to work. So you've got to be very careful. People think just because you put it on there, well, I treated. But if you don't get a good treatment, the other way to do it is after you treat, do this again. And that really gives you a good indication. With all the USDA hazards, we used to have to do. We'd have to follow up, retreat, and then we'd have to follow up, and then do another treatment post to see what kind of effect it had. And even the ones that get under the cappings, you don't know how many, Jeff and I had to uncap and count the number of dead mites versus live mites to see percentages. And we'd get percentages of how many mites under the cappings were even killed. So. This gets very technical. For new people, don't, you know, just do this. If you've got high five or more mites after doing double wash of one of these, you know you're going to treat. Now, if you don't, you can see the mites up here. I don't know if this pointer is... Oh, there it is. Okay. You can see the mites. Here's a good example. You bang a frame in here, and that one, you can already tell. The mites have gotten that. That one is collapsing already from mites. But on this car, we got 13 mites. But you can see with the board on the bottom, people look for how many mites. Those are dead mites that fall. Live mites, they're like little ticks. You're taking chill bees, worker bees, then with tweezers. Look under those abdominal sections, take tweezers. You'll see them under there. And it's like to try to get them off the bee, they're like little ticks in there, sucking the blood from the bee. So you got to do something. All I'm saying, use this as a guide. I can't recommend here. Your club officers or whatever can recommend what's best to use at what time of season. That's where you probably should get your information. Now, that's that brochure you see. It's got every possible treatment that's okay here in Massachusetts, and you can refer to that. I've got a bunch of these you can take with you. But anyway, you can see, now, drone scratching. People scratch drones and say, geez, I don't see any mites. Now, if you're going to do drone scratching, make sure the eyes are purple on the drones. The mites take on their coloration. As you can see here, the nymphs are white. They're colorless, and you won't see them. But once a drone takes on its purple eyes, you'll see the beige, the mites start take on that coloration. And you can see the male mites and the female mites. And it's interesting to see when, like I said, the USDA, we were looking at the male mite versus the female mites, and you could see the males sit up much smaller, it's tinier. But what happens is the female mite gets under the capping with two little tubules under the, you know, that whitish bee bread that the larva feed on? Very tricky here. She hides under that bee bread with two little tubules exposed to breathe. As soon as it's capped over, the female mite emerges, lays 4 to 5 fertile eggs, makes the female mites, one unfertile makes the male mite. Well, guess what? They come out, they hatch, they get right on that larva, start sucking blood to grow and strengthen up, and then they mate. In this case, unlike the bees, the the brothers and sisters mate, and guess what's emerging? All these mites. And it's exponential. So that's and you think, well, this isn't bad. But under those cabins, there's stuff going on. A lot of it. And like I said, we, after treatments, we'd have to open them up and we'd see what kind of kill we got. And you can see they right to the, right on the larva. And some, what happens is the larva and the pupa never make it to full adulthood. They die under the cappings. And then what happens is they start uncapping. They know they're dead, they're not respirating, the capping is sunken. The bees uncap it, and that's where they then pull out the dead larva. And you see that speckled pattern of your brood. And you blame the queen because you think it's the queen, but it's not. And you can see the other thing that, once it gets real heavy, you can see here the deformed wings, in some cases deformed legs, deformed body from too much blood being sucked out. And they vector viruses, deformed wing virus, acute paralysis virus, chronic paralysis virus. There's four or five of them that we found. So as a result, we even found one of the rarer ones in Worcester. So you can see what it looks like. You start seeing, and people say to me, well, I did see a couple, two or three with deformed wings. Well, guess what? You're never going to see 20 or 30 because virus bees are thrown out of hive. They leave the hive. That's the bees' way of handling, trying to kick them out that doesn't spread. But at that point, it's already too late. You got the viruses and the hive will collapse. So you're never going to see a lot. So don't think because you only had three deformed wing bees, that means you're in trouble already if you're starting to see deformed wings. Yes?
I know bees are very hygienic. Do they, then, does the queen have an aversion to those infected cells?
Does the queen defect?
No. Bees are very hygienic.
Yes.
So after the cells have been infected and the bees clean them out, does she still go and lay eggs in those
yes.
again?
Oh yeah, she does. She'll try to refill. But again, the queen oftentimes starts giving up. You see, this is the part of the big picture. She starts doing a nice brood rearing that she does because, first of all, the bees are dying of viruses. They're not tending to the larva. So, and that's what I was talking about. That's where all my collapse. You start seeing one or two uncapped white pupa heads. If you see one or two, that's not too bad. I only saw two. But guess what? There's hundreds of others under those cappings. The same thing's going to happen. The mites are sucking blood. So it goes from 2 to 30 to 200 to 900. And before you know it, you've got this whole pattern. See the uncapped? See the uncapped chewed off? They chew off the head because it's large. They can't pull it out. And instead, you'll see chewed off, or you'll see the pupa head itself, like right here. They uncap it, and then they chew off the head, and they pull out. It's easy. I watch them. They pull out the rest of the body very easy. It's a lightweight. With the head, it's hard, so they decapitate it. And that's what you see. Pupa heads decapitated pupa, and they pull them out. And see, it leaves a speckled pattern. What I was showing you, the one before, that speckled pattern. It's not the queens. It's that they're cleaning out the dead larva. So mites, a big issue, and you can see eventually you get this speckled pattern, fewer and fewer bees, because virus bees leave the hive, and people always go, well, Ken, like 2-3 weeks ago, I had loads of bees. Now there's nothing in the hive. Well, that's because the virus bees leave the hive, and all you find is that all uncapped pupa heads and pupa in there left behind, and the virus bees all gone in an empty hive that's collapsed. That's mites, and that's the majority of the losses we're facing with that. And you can see the speckled patterns here. Now, the setup of the hive is, you can see, bees, the way they set up a hive, and this is the perfect pattern. Most of it is females, the worker bees, brood, out in the corners, you can see what they think of boy bees, not much, and pollen and honey, that's the perfect frame. The working bees got the honey and the pollen close, they chew it up, make the bee bread, feed the worker. It's a well-organized system that they've got. I love to see those frames set up like this. You know that's the perfect setup that you want. Now, talking about honeybound, and I'll go back. Honeybound right here, that's a honeybound frame. You've got that, you've got the top wood chamber like I saw yesterday. 10 frames, just like that. No, not a single space left for brood. That's what you don't want right now. Come the end of October, guess what? That's what you want. It reverses itself. But not until the end of October. You still got plenty of time to feed during November and fill up those frames. And she'll start constricting. Third week of October, last week of October, she's already constricting that brood. By the second week of November, brood rearing is done on this part up here. Certain seasons, they've gone a little longer.
How many frames of honey and pollen do you want by the going into the winter?
Honey and pollen, I go, if I get it, my top brood chamber is those frames, three-quarter full of honey. I find that is sufficient. I can tell, I just go and lift from both sides and tell if it's to the point you can't lift it. That's enough honey. You know, you'll find it. Your hive is coming up easy. Don't do it from back to front. That's what I do. From each side. Do each side. You'll be able to tell where the bees are going to be settled. Because sometimes one side is all honey, and the bees will settle right there. And this side is lighter. But I like all 10 filled up. Again, that's a nice pattern, but you can already see here. See how? 1, 2, 3 pupa heads. Already starting. That's already telling you you got a lot of mites. So tree. See how they're closing? They're closing. In this case, the picture here, they're closing in. Going to make it honey bound. When I see the hives, top brood chamber, there's only two frames like that. All around it is the nectar, right in here filled in. You can see they're just closing. They're going to close in and make it honey bound. Now, the other thing while you're doing your evaluation, see, all this is being done at the same time when you do your inventory. It's all a one-time thing. It's not like you're doing going one day and check, okay, honey bomb. Next day, disease. You're doing it all at once, and it's a lot. And now you're looking, what do I have any problems? Do I have chalk brood? Do I have sac brood? Do I have something that's abnormal? I tell a list of people, first year, second year beekeepers, don't worry about what it is. Just know what's normal. So when you go through your hives in your final inventory, all the pupa in a nice C-shaped white crystalline, not yellow. Do I see any puncture marks, small little puncture marks, sunken cappings? That's abnormal. And then you can probe it with a toothpick and call somebody, call it and get an inspection, or call a mentor and say, something's going on. I want it, because you can clear it up. Like I found 2 weeks ago, a case with European farm brood. The gentleman had European farm brood, pretty widespread. So we got him on a treatment, it's cured up. I just went back to his hive, cured up nicely. Had I not caught that, guess what? He would have went into winter with that. Guess what, next spring, the hive would have been wiped out. So any abnormalities, call somebody, see what it is, and then you can rectify it. See, puncture cappings there, you see? You know, sunken, punctured. You don't want to see that. If it's punctured, sunken, you find that. You don't want that for sure. That's the worst of the worst. American farm brood. And that's what you don't want, because if you find that and it's in late stages, you know what happens in the fall with bees? They rob. And guess what? Everybody's bees robbing that. You're going to have an epidemic of American farm brood. That's the worst of the worst. And I found the year, 9 years ago in Holden, fall, robbing, 9 beekeepers all came down with it, including the chief of police there in Holden, and just spread like wildfire. The bees are all robbed out from gentlemen who had it. And so you don't want to see that kind of, you got to close it up. In this case, in Massachusetts, now we got to burn American farm brood. Kim has issued, anybody that's got American farm brood, people used to be able to treat for it and keep it suppressed. But now you have to burn the hive for European. But if you, and you know, there's a picture of what it looks like. It's awful. You don't want to face it. And if it's unkempt, see how it is? You see yellow here? See the yellowish? European farm brood. You don't want to go into the winter with that. It's treatable with antibiotic terramycin and cures up very nicely. This gentleman went and got a prescription from the vet, cured it up, I just went back to recheck. Looks beautiful, brood, nice. He got it just in time before the winter months. He caught it. And, you know, when I found it there, I says, you got to get on some treatment. And he did, and boom, nice hide now. There, see the little, well, you start to see, it's a nice white crystalline, see it? All the little yellowish, brownish look. That's, no. You want white crystalline C-shape, not twisted, contorted. See it? That's what it looks like when you dig it out of the cell. It's yellowish, brownish. See it? Or this close up. That's what happened, and that's your pin. So, if you're seeing that, call a mentor, call inspection. Chart root, if you're seeing that, again, call somebody. These are all abnormal abnormalities. You know, now the new law, we used to be able to get antibiotics and termicin like that from the dealers. Now you got to go through a vet unless you know somebody that won't say anymore. The law says you got to go to a vet. And that's chalk root. That's usually not a problem anymore, but I did find a few cases of that. But I say, let it go. Usually the bees will take care of it. If it's really bad, widespread, you might want to cull that frame out of there, because chalk root, that fungus, it's a fungus, it jumps from one frame, spreads itself, then jumps to the next frame. So oftentimes it's better to take that one frame out, and it's like little pellets, chalky, spongy. You feel them? I use it when I'm stressed out there, I start squeezing like a Nerf ball, and they're spongy. Right, Ed? See it? You'll find it on your bottom board. Because they pull them out, they drop them, and it's their way of grooming. Now, in insulation, but before, insulation, that's a personal preference. I don't use it, some people do. I don't think there's anything wrong, as long as you don't over-insulate and stop ventilation. What bees need is ventilation. You got that 3-inch opening on your entrance reducer, air comes in, moves through, takes the moisture out through that little notch in the top. As long as you got ventilation, if you're finding moisture on your inner cover, guess what you gotta do? Put some popsicle sticks on the lids, or you can use absorbers up there. But if you're finding moisture on the inner cover, that's saying you gotta do something to get better ventilation. Call a mentor and say, what should I do? All right, so that's an important factor, because more than cold, cold doesn't do it, kill the bees. It's the moisture dripping off that cover onto the bee cluster, and that's the dangerous part. So ventilation is important. So this stuff here, I've seen people now, well, guess what? It's not good, good idea, because robbing. And they can't protect the upper entrance. That's a mistake people make it. And I've gone a number of people with the robbing now, the nectar flow is kind of stopped, or the bees that I can tell right away, because my honey house has 165 honey supers in it. Yeah, when there's a honey flow, nectar flow, they could care less. But nectar flow stopped, thousands of bees are on my honey house trying to get in because there's nothing out there. So what do you think they're doing? They're trying to go at each other. Bees are relentless that way. They'll go after the hive next to it. If it's weaker, they'll take it down and rob it all out. So that just invites itself to robbing. Now, this time of year, early in the spring, the summer, the nectar fall, that's fine, it's a hot day. But when you get now robbing, I wouldn't advise that big of a popsicle sticks. You get just enough to get the moisture out. And that's a mouse guard. Now, entrance reducers and mouse guards, just about now, you should be putting them in, because mice start to get in. Probably not yet, the bees are active, but in another 2 weeks, the bees get, the cluster's getting colder, the mice are gonna get right in. I'll share just a quick story. This past spring, I've never seen this before. This is the first time in all my years of beekeeping. I'm cleaning my bottom boards. All of a sudden I come to one, there's this big clump of propolis. And I go in there and look closer than I knew. Propolis totally was this mouse. The tail, the whole mouse, a hard propolis. All I saw on it was the eyes, nose, and mouth. It was like, And it was glued to the bottom board. I should have brought it. It's neat to see. I should have brought this with me because I did take it out to Bristol. I was stopped by it. But I think it's neat. You know what? They knew that that mouse was wrong. They couldn't pull it out like a bumblebee they could pull out or anything. The mouse is just too big and the decay, the smell. It's phenomenal. Obviously, they stung it to death. In there, I put the entrance reducer in, the mouse was in. So before you put in the entrance or your mouse guard, make sure you don't have a mouse in there. That's not that, it kind of felt bad. You know, my wife kind of felt bad for us. She said, poor mouse must have been getting stung, couldn't get away, you know, the thing is, but get your mouse guards in because you don't want mouse, what they'll do for the new beekeepers, if you haven't seen this, they get in there, bees up in the cluster, they get in that bottom corner, chew through five or six frames totally, eat the pollen out of there, and ruin the frames on you. So mouse guards need to be put in. Bears, you want to protect against bears. Here, you're not so bad, but I'm already getting a call from Petersham. I got a call from New Braintree. Bear damage. One guy in Sterling, five hives, totally. A mom, he's got it on a hunting camera.
Yeah.
A mom and two yearlings. Yeah. The mom was knocking the hives over. Frames came apart, the two were just sitting. The neatest thing, they're sitting, chewing away. You see it right in the video, the frames, they eating them up. You know, five fire is just like a battlefield there, still in mass. So be careful around here. You know, I've got two hives I've had, one in Sutton and one in down in Uxbridge. Uxbridge had four or five bear attacks down there. So they're starting to get spread themselves. Now, feeding over winter, and feeding come the end of October, early November, if you don't have enough honey to get those 8-9 frames, your best top feeders, they can't eat the syrup. With a jar right up above that hole in the entrance, in a cover, you put it there with 15 or 16 tiny, tiny holes, the bees will come up, and they'll come right around the neck of the jar and warm it up so that the bees taking it, it's warm. Because you get cold nights, cold mornings, that syrup is cold. And they can't consume it unless it's 70. So what happens is, with a jar feeder, I recommend that's probably the best feeding system. Now, the last two things, supersedure and swarming. I got a call, this was 2 weeks ago now, a guy from up there in Bolton, Mass, calls me and said, Ken, he says, my hive just swarmed. I said, did it? He says, yeah, I got a swarm. I said, where is it? He says, what should I do? He says, it's up in the pine tree. I said, climb the tree and get it. You know? He says, I can't go 40 feet. So I said, no, I don't respect that. I was just kidding, you know? And I said, get a tree company. We called the tree company, $400. He said, on that account, I'm not going to pay $400 to... I can get a package the way he looked at it financially. And, you know, some, and I don't blame him. You know, it's $400, a lot of money to get a swarm. So he's going to get a package. I says, it's unlikely. I went out to his hive, very, very few bees. Unlikely, because what's going to happen is the old queen left. You know, what he's got behind is a new queen. There's no way she's going to get mated this time of year. There's no way that even if she did, that they could build up enough bees. You could possibly get a new queen and have her find the queen, cut, get her out. But that's a gamble. Queens are hard to get, and if you have to send for them, not at like $40-something, $25 for the queen and $20 for mailing, $45, which is a gamble if she's going to be able to bring the hive back anyway. So swarming, it still happens. Last year, I had one October 13th. October 13th, somebody called me with a swarm. So it does happen. You know why? I recommend you check under your top brood chamber. Lift it up, smoke them lightly. If you're seeing queen cells like this gentleman Bolton here, six of them, six queen cells just like this right here, and nothing he could do at that point. And so I said to him, you know, and I didn't blame him, $400. He could have got the swarm, set it right next to the hive, and then let that old queen keep laying. The new queen, if she didn't make it, that's fine. Then he could have combined them through newspaper. That's what I mean about combining bees. He could combine the two, and he's got a hive that would stand the chance. But without that old queen, that's what the hive, little chance to run. Supersedure, what I recommend, supersedure, you're only going to see one cell or two cells. And people think they have to be up on the half on the side of the frame. That's not the case. Oftentimes, they'll put a supersedure cell down low. And at this time of year, new queen is not going to get mated, not going to make it. So I recommend, if you see, make sure the old queen's still there. And she is usually until the new queen's about to hatch. And take, cut out the queen cell. That won't kill them, as long as they haven't done it already. Take out and cut out the supersedure cells. If they build it back, try it again. And because it's August 31st, you usually, I say, get another queen. At this point, it's that cost factor to get it. Try keep cutting it out. That won't kill the old queen unless if you keep cutting out the supersedure cells. But I wouldn't recommend it. See the swarm cells here? And of course, the new queen hatches out, the old queen leaves. For new beekeepers, that's why you need to catch that swarm. And then you got a chance. And there's your swarm. Nice swarm. Yeah, a beauty. Send me a picture. Swarm. I'd say it's 5-6 pound swarm. Usually it's smaller in the fall, but not in this case. So anyway, and one last thing here. I want to point out the, where is it here? Oh, right here. Last year I had a situation, my own bees robbed out, and other bees, they brought back viruses. I lost some hives. You're only as good as the beekeepers around you. It's good to encourage everybody to take care of the mites. A place like Northborough, Captain DeGraff started a whole group. They all get out and treat together, all the hives in that whole area of Northborough. And it's working. It's amazing how their survival, I tracked Kathy, gave us everybody in that area, all those beekeepers, and their losses were only about 22% in California. Versus other areas, if you're in an area and you get high mites and they got viruses that are vector, guess what? It's only natural for bees to rob. And viruses are transmitted mouth to mouth, live bee to live bee. Once the bees are dead, the virus is Judy Chin from Bellsville. Viruses aren't transmitted from the equipment. But they are transmitted. So you got a weak hive down the street, it's got viruses, it's got heavy mites. Not only are they coming back with viruses, those mites are looking for fresh hosts. They jump off onto your bees. You get a quick bill, even though you had it treated. And what happens is they're coming back with in quick buildup with mites.
We do it all too. We divide it up into groups.
Yeah.
And they were talking to each other and they're treating at the same time.
I think that's a great idea.
And we'll collect all the data through the winter and see.
Yeah, I'd be curious to see what areas where they did. And that's what I did with Kathy's group, that area up there, and much lower losses. And I saw it with my own experience last year. I lost that one site. I lost all five. That's rare for me to lose that all in one area.
And what were our losses last year?
What's that?
What were our losses when we tallied it all together?
Last year?
Yeah.
44%.
Yeah. I was up speaking to the main beekeepers, 75%. I did the main state beekeepers. I couldn't believe it. But they actually took a survey of all that beekeepers, 75% were not sustainable. No? So anyway, with that, you're only as good as the best beekeeper around you, and so you got to all work together to make this successful. So even though you do everything right, if other people run you out, guess what? You're going to lose your bees because not your own fault. But you have a responsibility. You all heard that a bee haver, beekeeper and a bee haver, you know, you want to be a beekeeper and for the good of all beekeepers around you, do be a responsible beekeeper and do what you should do, and that way everybody's going to be better off. I think part of the problem out there is there's just so many new beekeepers. We're still at 379 beekeepers. So guess what? All new beekeepers. So it's understandable. They make mistakes, you know, and you can't blame them. But when you're a senior beekeeper and you're making mistakes, then, well, wait a minute. You'll be happy or beekeeper. you know, there's no laws that you have to be a beekeeper. You can be a bee haver. There's nobody can stop you that way. So it hurts everybody, though, in the long run. So that's what I'm saying with that. All right, I'll open up to some questions. Thank you. I'm not a great speaker, but I do know my material. That follow along with this, I didn't have a chance to run these off, and what I presented is the best of beekeeping the problems to save your beehives. The best that you can do. All right, so two questions, and we'll.
I'll can email those notes to me, and we'll send them out to everybody. And remember, if you see anything, you see those things that Ken showed you, you're not sure what you're looking at, whatever. There's plenty of people you can ask. Don't just wonder and flounder. There's plenty of people ready to help you. Email me, you can call me. I can't come help everybody, but I can get people to help you. You post on Facebook, Kathy Hunter, me, Scott Montford, people who, we monitor. We're always watching the Facebook stuff, trying to answer questions. You can post pictures. We can try to help you with that. You have a mentor. You don't have a mentor, I'll get you a mentor. I'll be your mentor, whatever. But just ask instead of, let them go. This is what the purpose of our club is to help beekeepers succeed. All right? So yes. We got some time for some questions. Yeah. So go ahead.
We had always been told that we should be wrapping up feeding by the middle of October because you didn't want moisture in your hives much later than that. But you're saying that
they'll start, you'll see, by the third week of October, anyway, she's constricting her brood, and they're filling up. There's still stuff out there, aren't there? It's just not as plentiful.
Right.
It's very slow. But they start filling up, constricting the brood about the third week. And that's the deal on it. That's fine. But most of September, October, you want to open. And then if you vent in November and you feed them, that's the problem. You've got to vent it. So enough popsicle sticks to get the moisture out when you're feeding.
But it's okay to still be feeding in November if you feel they're overwhelmed.
Right, November.
Okay.
I do with my own. Right now, I got at the farm out there. I got we use a big chest freezer, big walk-in, and I got probably 150, 200 honeybound frames. I'm no different. I don't know why bees do honeybound. Miles feedback. I asked her once, and she says once they stop putting it in, if you don't put your supers on, her answer was, they stop filling the brood chamber, and you put supers on then. They will finish filling up the brood chamber before they move up. So get your supers on before the big flow comes, and I found that to be true for the most part. This year, I got caught short because it came late. The nectar flow, there was nothing, and it came late. And in a fall like this, bees tend to want to store for the winter, so they brought it down, and they honeybound. So it was kind of a strange year this year.
Okay,
thank you. I have one question. Something I read recently. So when your top box going into the winter, whether you're eight frames or 10 frames, one could be your second or third, that you should put like one or two built-up empty frames right in the middle in anticipation of end of January, February, April.
In January, February?
I mean, you're going in, say, in November, and you've got your brood down.
Between your honey, you said?
No, I mean, your very top box going right into the winter, to leave at least one, or if not two, drawn-out frames.
See, if they're settled, they usually settle down right at the top of the bottom box. And they move up, and they clear up. They eat that coming up, and your brood is in the middle. You could, but if that cluster, that's leaving less honey in the middle, and anybody knows about beekeeping the way they do it, they come up and start putting brood, and then if they run out honey, there could be honey 8 inches away out to the sides, but they stay with the brood to keep it. It's self-defeating in nature. Why bees don't move and save themselves and start brood rearing, but instead they stay right with the brood. How many do I find starved hives in the winter, like last year? Kim let me go all winter to check out dead outs and to look. The main cause, they bees with their brood, nice brood already started, and they starved right there, and it was honey out to the side frames. So that would defeat that whole thought, because now you got one less frame of honey. They'll clear out as they move up. They're clearing up, and where do you find all your brood in the spring? Right up in the second brood chamber near the top. And with the USDA study, we found in the spring, when she's up in the top brood chamber, people start rotating. We found the pattern that a queen will do, will go 4 to 5 across. Then she comes in an inverted pyramid down and squares off. Starts in the middle and squares off. And they automatically, the whole system set. When you start reversing, you mess things up. The system, we found it tracked it time and time again. 4 to 5 across, then down in an inverted pyramid, and she will square. When the temperature gets right, the temperature isn't by the sun, that's the way the pattern is for bees. You know, like you said, I learned a lot with Jeff Patterson, the USDA survey. He's a brilliant, brilliant scientist, and not only a scientist, but a beekeeper. So, you know, myself, a lot of this type of scientific, had I not done it, gone through it, I wouldn't, you know, I thought about reversing, but there are a lot of misconceptions I now no longer do.
So we have 2 packages, 1 swarmed, we caught it. So we have 3 hives going. However, 2 of them are still in 1 bee. So going into the winter, we're considering we might have to combine them.
Yeah.
When should we?
Well, combining, that? Now you've got 2 queens laying and brood. But how many frames of brood in each one?
Well, we haven't done our full inventory, so I'm not sure. Maybe like 4 or 5.
See, some people, you can try winter in one. You can do it with feeding, water feeding, and whatever. There's just not enough food in one brood chamber. What you can do is a number of things. This gets complicated, but what you have a number of choices. I like myself, I just combined. I had 8 of my own hives that were weak. I know I'm going to make it. I like a strong hive rather than 2 weak hives. I don't like gambles. Well, 2 might make it. I like 1, definitely the odds are making it.
So we should do that sooner rather than later to combine them?
Yeah. Right now is the time. You don't want to wait till too late. You can wait another couple of weeks, then combine them. Take one of the queens out, combine it to a newspaper, and they'll shoot through. They will combine, and you'll have a nice strong hive going into the winter as long as you did the other things, treated for mites and everything else. You got a nice strong hive coming out and make a split in the spring. Mm-hmm. Or we've tried this again with the USDA study. We took those weak ones, put up above a 2 print where the heat was, double screen board we call it. Mm-hmm. We put a double screen board and then winter them up above. In other words, on top of the 2, that one hive has got 2 strong hive, that you've got a 2 frames, you can take 1 of those and put it above, and if you had another hive, you could put the other deep, and you got a strong hive. The only thing is, when you got to start feeding sugar patties, in the spring, you got to lift off that, and that's where the problem is. It's a tough up here in the Northeast. Well, it's not the fact of lifting. The clusters you break up and you got to keep it open longer. And what I find here with those scales I've got, and I can tell right away the temperature, I got actually 3. The temperature last year, January 24th, is when the hives started their first brood. How I know that is the temperature. I got on a computer, those scales are computerized. January 24th, from January 18th, the 24th, the temperature was like 65, 70. It started slowly. It doesn't all of a sudden happen. Over the course of a week, they brought it from 70 up to 90. Amazing. You see, when you see the computer readout, how slowly they brought that temperature up, producing eating more. That's why, come January, they start really. You don't see much eating up until January. Then all of a sudden, you start to see it. It's starting to move up pretty quickly. Well, think about this. They have to now start bringing up to 90. Guess what they're doing? Eating more to bring the temperature up more because it takes more energy. And I saw that, and that's why I say January 24th is when. Now, the problem is brood rearing started. But why I got a sore, a lot of people don't. I shouldn't give them my secrets, otherwise everybody's going to be successful. What good will I be? But anyway, here's what trick. I found this over the last 8 years. I started trapping pollen in the spring, the previous spring. Like, there's plenty of pollen out there. You can trap for 1 or 2 days from each hive, and I freeze it. Come January, about the 3rd week of January, I put pollen, I put my sugar patties right next to the, on wax paper, right on the frames, right next to the cluster. So if they eat up all the honey in, underneath and there's no honey, it's a cold spell, they can't get out there, the sugar patties will sustain them. Well, I found about 9 years ago, I started taking this frozen pollen, pressing it into the sugar patties. I've had people come out with me for my individual hives. And when you put that fresh pollen, unthawed, on there, they can smell. It's almost like they come running saying, thank you, thank you. And what that does is I get brood rearing early because you get a cold spill. They can't get down to the pollen while that pollen is down below. They can't get to it. And that's the difference. Pollen patty would do it, but it's not with fresh pollen. I've tried pollen patties in the past. I put a pollen patty, some of the beekeepers come out with my hives. A lot of them come out with me when I'm doing all my management, whatever it's included. Used to be able to do it with the state, but now we can't because of, you know, privacy issues. So, but they come out with me, I show them. You put the pollen patty here, the fresh pollen here, they don't even, they run right to the fresh pollen. It's amazing. And they start consuming every week. You have to, once you start though, they start brooding. I got to put pollen in there every week so they can sustain that brood rearing. But that's, like I said, I shouldn't be giving away those secrets.
So I have a situation where one of the hives in the queen, beginning of September, moved down.
Yeah, can you just speak up a little?
Sure. So I have a situation where one of the hives, the queen started moving down, moved down into the bottom box and was just laying there. Even though I had open frames, she wasn't laying in the top box. And over the month, now it's about 70% full. So should I put any energy into making sure the top box is open? Will she move up at all?
Well, she'll.
I mean, she hasn't the whole month. She just.
How many frames of brood do you have down below?
So 4 or 5.
You're close. If 7 is ideal. Sometimes if there's enough, they'll stay there. But they sense this instinctive of how much they need. And that's why we found with the USDA, 7 to 8 in September, October is what they had. Because we did brood counts every 2 weeks. So we knew what they kept and what a good amount of brood is in there. I'm not just giving you a saying, no, that's okay. That's what we found, that the bees up here in the Northeast tend to have in September, October for a strong cluster. We did have some, and I can tell you, we had one that was weighed 4.5 pounds. The cluster was only 4.5 pounds. But we look back at the brood counts in that hive, it wasn't even close to 7 or 8 frames.
So do you think I should only worry about the bottom box and make sure those are all open and not be able to talk?
Well, if she's down there, right now it's turned cold. At this point, it's kind of late. You know, if you had honey up there and you had some brood up there, then the other thing you do is to try to initiate, move some of the frames of brood up, but close your brood together. Down below, if you're going to do that, close it together and put right up above, because then they can make their cluster this way. If you take empty frames down here, it spreads out the brood. They can't keep that warm. So I wouldn't make that move. You're going to do it, condense them together, put your honey frames and pollen out to the side, and then 4 other frames up above, 2 with brood and 2 empty ones right there, and condense those right up above the 2 lower ones. I've done that myself too. And then you got 8 frames, and they can keep a cluster, whereas your top, you had the frames out here and down here, they just, you can't split the forces. You gotta keep the forces working together. Yes?
I was gonna do a oxalic treatment. I've already done right away, say in December. What's a good date where you're pretty sure?
Well, I can't get into recommending, I'm sorry, but you know, we're not allowed to get into recommendations and that, so I have to stay away, because of all the different businesses and whatever, we sort of stay free.
Huh? We rephrase the question.
When's brood rearing count?
Well, the best time to do it is when you have when there's no brood.
Right, but if you were going to guess a date, December 1st?
Well, yeah, you know, you look for a day in, if you're going to do vaporization, you can do it.
It's got to be above 37 degrees.
Yeah, so pick a day like that. You do a dribble, like I had a 55 degree day in December last year. It did the dribble method too. But you got to have so much, there's so much brood to do it right now.
Yes, back in for a second before.
I took a honey supers on. names.
Yeah, I should have gone, did honey in?
So, I took them off.
Okay.
And it had some nectar in it. And I don't have a really big freezer. Would you freeze nectar?
Yeah, you can freeze nectar and not have it ferment.
Right, but if I left it in a sealed container, will it ferment?
Fine, you can spin it out and feed it right back to the store.
Yeah, if I didn't, oh, you can spin it out.
Yeah, you can spin it out and feed that back instead of with your sugar syrup, if you don't have much of it, feed it back with your sugar syrup. And that way, there's nutrition in there that the sugar syrup doesn't have. All, like with me, I'm able to freeze all those frames. Now, the end of October, early November, I just have to go back and put them in there. And I don't have to start doing a lot of feeding. I want to get a little bit of fumigillin in for my Nozema. So I do feed some, but I use some of the, I got honey supers there that are uncapped that we took off with my crew there. And those, I spin out separately, then I feed that right back at the end of October, early November, with the sugar syrup, because it's not enough of that. So if I'm deficient, I'm a believer in honey as much as you can for wintering and less on the sugar syrup if I can. Now some years you just can't, like last fall was a tough one. We've got nothing in the fall. We sprout early in the spring with all that honey, and of course I sold a lot of my honey and I needed the honey, so I did feed them and I found I lost. But of course part of it was probably sugar syrup because I found sac food. That's how I know. I find the years I feed a lot of sugar syrup, I find sac food virus much more common. And shock food, they seem to, and honey, there's stuff that combats these different, and you don't get it with the sugar syrup. So I...
Do you think the nectar will ferment if I just leave
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it's high moisture honey, it will ferment it. That's why when you take it and spin out honey, 80 to 20% will, 80% cap, 20% nectar mixed in, no more than that, because if you get too much moisture, it's going to ferment on there. But you can spin out and feed it back. Yes.
Is it more important to have the top box filled with honey, or is it more important to have that column in the middle with honey on the sides?
No, the crowns aren't going to do it, because they need to have it right close to all full, because when they come up out of that barbarugium, they warm. The honey warms. What they do, they have a system. The honey up above them warms up as in that cluster. They move some of the bees loosely up higher to start warming that honey, because they have to have it at 70 degrees. So you've got a crown, they got to go through all that empty space, and they're going to run out of honey up there. You need full frames. By the end of November, you want full frames. There's a little space, that's okay for them to come up and sell it, but you want pretty much, you don't want just crowns on that second brood chamber. See, it reverses. Right now you want two-thirds brood. From the end of November, you want all honey in that where the brood was. And that's, yes.
I have a first year high, and I have a super top with a queen excluder. So it's probably about 7 frames of mediums of honey. Should I just leave that on?
Well, you can leave the excluder on. Take the excluder out, you can leave it up there so they come through. You want a lot of people. I'm more concerned about the bees, don't care about the honey. Yeah, leave it. I'll tell you, that's extra insurance. They'll come right through that, and you'll have your brood in the spring and your honey super, which is okay, because you can then move it down but if you use certain treatments, you can't keep the honey supers on. That's the only other issue that you've got there. So if you're not non-treatment, that's not an issue, absolutely. And some people keep one honey super, that they only got one or two hives for each hive that they use just for that. And they winter, it's no question, they winter on honey, much better than sugar syrup, and that's insurance. That extra super of honey is insurance for they're not going to starve out and they can keep moving up. And bees will move up, that's why top bar hives, this way, they can't heat it up to the sides. That's a tropical hive, initially. And so that's why with the top bar hives, you know, a number of years ago, I was doing, started looking at that when I kept the stats. Out of the 52 top hives that year, 41 didn't make it. It's a tough one to, nice hive, they look good and everything, but it's tough to winter. I suggested top bar people maybe build a second story on the top bar, and that would give them the ability to be able to heat the honey up a problem. Yes?
Okay, going back to her situation, of the newer hives that are in the one brood box.
One brood box, yeah.
And that's great, combining them down to one, and picking the best queen. But what about reducing these to nukes? I hear people overwintering nukes.
Yeah, you can try, but I've tried it. I haven't had success with it. But I hear some people like in Vermont, they double nukes, two nukes with honey up above, and you know, it's not just one.
Well,
but
Jane,
honey up.
Jane went and learned in Vermont.
Jane's Lavoda
does that. Yeah, with honey up above the double, so you have honey up above, it's like one brood box and you have honey up above it. You can try that way if you have the honey super honey up above it. That is more likely to make it. Is you just try doing both in one with the two nukes, you get one, then you have to feed a lot of sugar patties to them during the winter months to sustain them. And I found that on sugar patties, they seem to die out. I never had success. If you have to do sugar patties too long, that's only a temporary thing to get to a warm period and then move honey over or let the bees shift and get the honey. But it's not a long-term solution. I find they don't winter. If you had to stop feeding in December and try to feed them on sugar patties, they don't seem to make it. They collapse. So something lacking again.
Yeah, what a lot of people have luck with is to do 5-1-5.
Yeah.
You know, you get the whole nuke setup. Don't just put them in a little nuke box. I mean, you know, with the bottom board, two deep or three medium boxes. So that you can like take your 10 for any, so if you have a 10 over 10 and the top box is empty and the bottom box has half brood and half honey, put the brood in the bottom, put the honey on top so that they're still vertical.
Yeah.
And then what I'm going to try doing this year is to make a top cover that doesn't have the overhang like you use for moving them, and you slide the nukes together so they're touching side by side. The idea is to have more than one, and what they'll do is they'll cluster on the inside walls, and the two nukes will keep each other warm like it was one big cluster on the wall. That's proven to work too.
Yeah.
But you can't just leave them with five frames.
All right, so the 5-over-5 is five brood and five honey above.
Russian carries those, but I've used those.
And then you have
the doubles.
Yeah, no beekeepers, if you're stuck and have to, that I'd say for experienced beekeepers, that more to try it out once you get some experience under your belt. It's a tough task to make it. We got time for more than one?
Yeah, a couple more.
We had a situation this summer, this year, with a neighbor who was treating for ticks and mosquitoes. Mosquito man,
right.
And they were actually pretty good. We got on their call list when they're going to come and everything. Right. They call us in the morning. But halfway through, they realized we had bees, we talked to them. And the company said they went to an organic pest
exam.
Do you bee friendly? They call it bee friendly. Yeah. Do you really think? So what we were doing, when they came, we'd cover the hive, a sheet in the morning, plug up the hole, cover the hive.
Yeah.
And we'd have to wait. Sometimes they wouldn't come to noon or whatever. The bees are just pushing that, the block, it's unbelievable, they just come out.
Sure.
But with the, they said they did the bee friendly. Do you think it really is a bee friendly?
There are organic, up in Upton, Ewan McCulley, you might want to talk to him. He has bees, the regular landscape, he was losing a lot of bees. He went to an organic company, and now, and it's in a place where everybody's got those $10,000 lawns and everywhere, everybody uses. Well, he's got everybody using that company now. Again, it doesn't affect the bees.
Okay.
It's where you get to call Ewan McCullough from Upton, is a friend of mine too. Everybody off a dairy drive up there, Upton Jews, and now they've all bought to him. Of course, it's more expensive.
It is.
It is more expensive, but it's organic. Versus, pesticide. But I can give Ed to Damon, the gentleman. He can discuss it. He can go see the lawn's still beautiful, and it's more expensive. So that's I think it's a decision on pocketbooks.
If you're talking to somebody about a particular, to a particular company, it's just ask them what the material is. You know, and then you can research it. You can send it out to club lists, whatever people, somebody might have experience with it. But I think rather than somebody just saying, oh, be friendly, because
they
have been issues with that in the past. Give me the name, trade name, chemical name, whatever it is, and research it. I think that's the best way to go.
Yeah, I called the mosquito guy because two doors down was doing it, and they said it was some sort of garlic essential oil, the bee friendly one version.
Yeah, potters, you got to close up your hives, no question about it. And they're spraying and want to close up hives, and then but on a hot day, you can't keep them closed up more than about 3 or 4 hours in the morning. So you got to ask them, do it, can you do it at night? Do it later at midnight and whatever. And then the LD50 is much better. You're going to get fewer losses in the, but if they're out there on spraying and the bees are out there, it's just natural. But with that, thank you very much.
Thank you.